to you by Mohegan Sun Connecticut. Unlimited possibilities await you at Mohegan Sun. Tony, down in warm Port St. Lucie, Florida.
There you are. Are you there right now, Tony?
No. I'll tell you a story about how cheap the Wilpons are.
Okay.
The Yankees are playing the Mets here next month.
Right.
If you wanted to buy tickets to see the Yankees for the one game that's here, you had to buy tickets for two other games.
Two other games.
That's called good business. That's called good business.
I thought maybe you were going out to lunch with them and you had to pay.
That'd be an example of
right, that would be, yes.
Tony, I get why as a fan that's not ideal, but that's called good business. You know, they know Yankees Mets is a hot ticket, so they're saying, "Hey, you want to buy this ticket? You got to buy."
Well,
how much
is spring training games? They can't be that much.
They vary in price. They vary in price. Sometimes they change based on the opponent.
Well, give me like a max. Let's say for a Yankee game, what are they charging?
They're
charging you $50?
I got to be honest. I haven't been to a Met Yankee game in spring training.
Can't be charging you like $100, can they?
I don't know, but I've been to non-Yankee games in Port St. Lucie, and they're like $20 if you want to sit in a lower grandstand.
No, that's reasonable.
Where they were expensive, I remember, is Orlando, where the Braves would train on Disney. Like, it would be like $40 to get in. And we're talking about an exhibition game. Let's keep that in mind.
Right.
But, look, there's plenty of reasons to rip the Wilpons. We do it. But to knock them for a business decision, which is actually smart, which a lot of teams do. They try things like that where they raise the price based on the opponent.
The Mets are still doing the thing with the tickets, right, where you pay more for different games, right?
Yeah, I think everybody does it now.
Oh, are they all doing it now?
Yeah, I even think the Yankees do it. I think if you go through Yankee games, I'd have to ask a Yankee season ticket holder.
Right.
I think they price it based on the opponent. Mm. Jim in Middletown.
Hi, Jim. How are you?
Yeah, good morning, guys. How you doing? Jim. Yeah, and who's to say that the Yankees spring training against the Mets? Who's to say the Yankees don't even bring their starting players over there?
They won't. They probably won't. That's a good point.
You're right.
No, they won't. You know, and so it's all a marketing ploy, and it's good for them to make money. Listen, about the starting pitching, before I get to that, I don't know if you guys heard Francesa on with Salvacotta last night on OR, but they were saying that the Giants are very interested in Lagares, and the Mets really like Joe Panik.
It doesn't make any sense.
I mean, they already got Asdrubal making $8 million a year playing second base, and now Frazier's playing third. They're going to make that deal?
No, I think that, I listened, and it was good to hear
you told me that. Yeah, you mentioned it.
But that's a rumor from probably a month ago.
Right.
I mean, it just doesn't make sense anymore. Right. I mean, the Mets have filled out their infield right now. I don't think the Giants would trade Joe Panik for Juan Lagares either. I think they would want more. But the Mets have filled out their infield. I remember for a while, Todd Frazier was signed a little over a week ago now. But for a while, we were sitting here thinking the Mets could sign a second baseman or a third baseman.
What Mike was on with Sal Alcantara, right?
Yes.
You told me about it. I'd known about it. What's next, like the Today Show?
Maybe.
Is that already Fox and Friends? What's he on next?
Fox and Friends. Yeah,
I mean, he'll be making the right. Exactly. He'll be making the rounds. Unbelievable.
But I don't think there's any way the San Francisco Giants would take a 27-year-old former All-Star who's won a Gold Glove, who's a quality baseball player, and trade him for Juan Lagares, a guy that, you know, Juan Lagares has to prove something now. He's got to prove he can stay healthy.
Yep. And hit. He's got to prove he can hit. And not you know, break his thumb every year diving for a ball.
I mean,
how many years in a row has he done that? Like 3 years in a row?
I think every year of his career.
It's unbelievable.
And it's funny because when he first came up, you watch him defensively and you say, my God, if he just hits a little bit, you'd stick him in center field and play him every single day.
He's tremendous defensively.
Right, but over the last couple of years, because of these injuries, because of the fact you can't get him on the field on a consistent basis, and he hasn't grown as a hitter enough where he's at least suitable out there, you can't live with it. And that's why when you look at center field before Michael Conforto comes back, like, to me, I'm just giving Nimmo the job. The more I think about it, I'm just letting him be the center fielder for the first month. I know against lefties you'd sit him. Totally get that. Juan Lagares has had success against lefties. But against righties, which is most of the time, what would you say, like 80% of the time you're facing a righty starter?
You would think so. Probably, yeah, 75. Depends. In that range.
I'd play Nimmo. Because the thing about Brandon Nimmo, I'm not saying he's going to be a star or anything like that, but I kind of want to see him. Like, I want to see what he's got. I mean, the guy's only played, you know.
And Alderson loves him. He wouldn't trade McCutcheon for him, you know, him for McCutcheon. So let's see.
That's a great point.
Let's see.
It shows
let him play.
You,
why not? I'm all for that.
And here's the thing that he does that this team needs. Look, the guy's only stolen two bases in his career. So we're not saying he's a stolen base threat. but he gets on base at a very high clip.
Right, right.
If you look at the small sample size.
He's young. I can't
see
why he couldn't try to steal bases anyway. I mean, you don't have to have blazing speed to be an effective base stealer.
I agree.
You don't have to.
I'll give you a great example of that. David Wright.
Yeah, David Wright.
How many years did David Wright have where he actually stole a decent amount of bases?
No, you're right.
And then you've got the opposite. I don't mean to knock this guy because I was complimenting him before, but I always felt like Brett Gardner never stole as many bases as he should have, considering how fast he was.
Right.
But David Wright had a 34 stolen base year. David Wright.
Yeah.
Now, he had big stolen base years.
Boy. Too bad about David.
Nah, I know.
Every time I think about it, I feel bad.
Nah, it's a shame.
I really do.
I hope he does come back. I know I know that stinks for the Wilpons.
I think we're really, I don't know about that.
Yeah, probably. Alan in Queens.
Alan.
Hi, Joe. Hi, Evan.
Alan,
how are you doing?
What's going on?
Derek Jeter, our friend in Miami, who always made money for his partners.
Right. Exactly right. Hyman Roth.
Same as Hyman Roth.
Right, right. You know, exactly right. All right, so is that it?
Is that what we're doing?
All right, Alan, thank you very much. James in Daytona Beach.
James. Hey, how you guys doing?
James, how are you?
Good. I wanted to ask you something about the two bills, 30 for 30 program.
Yep, yep.
I found it very interesting that when Belichick had the chance to go up to Minnesota and Parcells pretty much told him, I understand if you want to go there because we're on shaky ground.
After the 83 season.
It seemed like Belichick really appreciated that, and that meant a lot to him, and maybe that's why he came back.
Right. He did say that, and he said that as well.
So then here's my theory, is that when New England sent them the fax to say, we'd like to talk to Belichick about coaching, Parcells did something very selfish, and he said, well, I'm stepping down, so this way Belichick has to become the coach of the Jets.
Right, right.
And I'm thinking maybe if he had done the same thing where he had said to Belichick, hey, look, I don't want you to go to New England. I don't like them, but I want you to have the opportunity. So you go and you interview with them. And maybe if he had done that, Belichick would have said after interviewing, you know what, I like New England, but Bill did that for me. I appreciate that a lot, and maybe I would stay with the Jets. Do you think that possible?
I don't, because I think what happened was once Leon Hess died, once he passed away, I don't think Bill did not like the Johnsons, did not like Woody Johnson. You know, Dolan was the other guy that was up for buying the Jets. He didn't like either of those guys. I don't know if that was happening. And I still maintain this, too. All right? I don't think Belichick ever wanted to follow Bill Parcells. I think that's a big part of it. I could be wrong. I do think that.
Yeah, I don't think we'll ever know the answer, but I will say that it probably would have been much better, not only for their relationship, but for the chances of him staying, for Parcells to have taken the approach that our last caller suggested.
Right, right.
Because
which he didn't
for
do.
Him to rush over after he gets a fax, the request from Bob Kraft that he wants to interview Bill, and for him to resign so that Belichick contractually is now the head coach of the team, is a move that he's not looking out for his friend at all.
No, he was putting him in a bad spot.
So what you do?
And he had to know he was putting him in a bad spot.
Of course.
So you think that Bill Parcells didn't realize that Kraft was interested in Belichick well before he got this fax?
No.
So
what you do is you say to Bill, look, Bill, Kraft is interested. Belichick.
Right.
Kraft is interested.
Right.
We'll allow you to interview, but we really want you here. I'm going to resign. We want you to be the head coach. Hear them out. But I'm telling you, this is the place to be. And you're trying to win him that way.
Yeah.
But by leaving to try to force him into being the head coach was not the best approach.
I tell you, you had said it, and I finally watched it over the weekend, and you're 100%. I mean, Belichick comes off a lot better than Parcells in this thing. No doubt about it.
Oh, yeah.
It's not even close.
James in Orange County.
James, how are you? What's up?
Hey, guys. How you doing?
Good, James.
Talk about the Yankees here with the pitching. It depends on which Tanaka shows up. Is this going to be the confused Tanaka that we saw last year, or is it going to be the stud Tanaka that we know we have in this rotation?
I don't know if I would use the word confused. I mean, he had a lot of bad outings where he really got, destroyed in those outings. But, he had a lot of games where he was phenomenal, too, and he obviously pitched well in the playoffs.
Look, the playoffs, he was amazing. Let's put that to the side, because the guy was
great.
Unbelievable in the postseason.
Right.
But in 2017, he had a bad year. Like, I get what you're saying, that he had a bunch of bad starts.
He had some real bad starts. He had some really good starts, too.
He did, but overall, I can't call it a good year.
Yeah.
Like, it was a bad year. You know what I mean? Like, for you to have that many bad starts where you basically pitch to a 5 ERA, look, sometimes your numbers can be a little kind of not misleading, like you said, because of the fact that you have a handful of bad starts. I thought that happened to DeGrom at times. I just think watching him, you really had no idea what to expect from him. You had zero idea. So I think it's a fair question. Are you getting 2016 Tanaka? Because that's the guy you want, because that's the guy who made 31 starts and pitched well.
Right.
So I don't know what to expect.
Yeah.
The fact that he was so good, though, in the playoffs is encouraging because that's the last thing you saw from him.
Yeah. One thing about Tanaka that I really feel with him is he's a pro. You know what I mean? I mean, he's a pro, Tanaka.
He's a pro, and look, for 3 years now, he has been pitching with that injury, basically the UCL hanging by a thread, and he's been able to get through it now for three seasons.
Yeah,
and you're confident that when there's a big game, Tanaka's going to show up.
Yeah, I agree.
More of your calls coming up.
All right, huge President's Day savings are going on right now at Security.